Good morning to you who are gathered here in the sanctuary on Rugby Road, and to all of you who are joining us online. As we come together, let's enjoy this music. Thank you so much for that beautiful music, John. Greetings, everyone, on this lovely day. Welcome to our community worship with the UU Congregation of Charlottesville. I am Greg Townsend, serving today as your worship weaver. Some of us are in the sanctuaries of our homes, joining in this community online. Welcome. Some of us are in the sanctuary on Rugby Road. This place was built for this congregation over 70 years ago on a hilltop setting on land that is the homeland of the Monacan people, and land that was once cared for by enslaved people from Africa. We honor all those who dwelt here before and all those in our congregation over the decades whose lives led to this moment of our gathering once again as a community of memory and hope. We are blessed by their memory. I invite you now to take a moment to greet others who are with you in worship this morning. Those of you on Zoom can unmute and say hello to one another. And those of you in the building, you can rise in body or spirit and turn to greet those close to you. It is so good to be with one another. We are especially happy to greet those of you who are with us for the first time. Welcome. A reminder for everyone in the sanctuary, to keep everyone as safe as possible, we ask you to keep your high quality masks in place, as I see everyone is doing. Thank you. Seating is also in the social hall this morning, where you can participate in worship by watching a live stream video on a large screen. The social hall is particularly welcoming to families with young children with a play space, including blocks and toys. Supervised play is also available on the playground during worship. We hope you will do what you need to do this morning to feel comfortable as we all do our best to care for one another and keep each other as healthy and safe as possible. Many thanks to all the folks helping us share worship, both here and online. Our on-site greeters, ushers, and hospitality and logistics team, and special thanks to our production team, including our new AV tech, Rachel Buckland, Sean Scally, Celia DeVoe, and our virtual usher, Laura Horn, supporting the dual platform worship both online and in the Rugby Road Sanctuary. And I'm happy to assist in UU Seville Director of Music, Scott DeVoe, for his service. Scott and the choir will be accompanied as usual by our pianist, John Mayhood, and we have two guest musicians with us today, Pete Sparr on bass and Robert Jospay on percussion. All music will be live today. Here to greet you from your Board of Trustees is Elizabeth Breeden. Welcome, Elizabeth.
Good morning. The burning question for the board over the last 3 years, as well as over the next 3 years, is how to be more welcoming. Certainly, we question how we are not as diverse as we wish to be. And as the people who have question marks burned on our lawns, we're really interested in the question, but are we interested in the answer? I think my little story for this morning is about Anna Gardner, who was a abolitionist from Cape Cod and a Unitarian who started our local Jefferson School in 1865. Clearly, Anna was called to approach the questions of education and what would be needed by the newly freed people. However, when she got here, she was here for about 10 years, she became increasingly disturbed by the passion and the fervor of her students when they went to revivals. She said they were unable to think or talk for days afterwards. And I think about that a lot, because I think Anna was a true Unitarian. And so how did she enjoy that there were others with such passion that they unnerved her sense of what it was to be religious? So I just thought that would be an interesting question for you.
Thank you so much, Elizabeth. I have a couple of announcements for us today. There is a swimming party this afternoon for our middle and high school youth from 4 to 8 p.m. Speak with Reverend Leah following this morning's service for all the details. Now, the recent Supreme Court decisions about abortion, the EPA, and gun rights got you down? Come share your thoughts and feelings at our congregation's Active Hope group. The group meets via Zoom tomorrow, Monday, July 11th, from 4 to 5:30 p.m. The Zoom link can be found on the church's webpage under Adult Faith Development. Join others who share your concerns and are there to help each other find the hope that's needed to act in a turbulent world. Email activehope@uucharlottesville.org with your questions. Our first of two summer yard sales is happening Saturday, July 23rd from 8 a.m. to noon and will feature clothes, toys, and books. Donations for the sale can be dropped off at Summit House on Tuesdays and Saturdays between 9 a.m. and noon through Tuesday, July 19th. Clothes, toys, and books only, please. Come, let us worship together as Scott centers us with Gather the Spirit. Thank you.
is the mystery of this hour. Our trials in this light appear all the same. Celebrate once again. Gather the spirit of heart and mind. Seeds for the sowing are laid in store. Nurtured in love and conscience refined. With body and spirit abounding.
Thank you so much for that. That was fantastic. I invite Patty Wallace to come forward to light our chalice this morning. As Patty makes her way up here, we can get the words of the chalice lighting up. There we go. All right, if we say it together, we gather this hour as people of faith. With joys and sorrows, gifts and needs, we light this beacon of hope, sign of our quest for truth and meaning, in celebration of the life we share together. And if we can now do the hand motions, Patty, we light this chalice to celebrate Unitarian Universalism. This is a church of open minds. This is a church of helping hands. This is a church of loving hearts. Thank you, Patty.
Thank you. Going on. Yeah, our reading is going to be actually an excerpt from a piece of music by William Parker, a New York composer. It's called Baldwin, and what you're going to hear is excerpts from an interview with James Baldwin, but as part of a jazz take on that interview.
The pictures of dogs in the hands of human beings attacking other human beings.
In a free country.
In a free country.
In the 20th century.
This Birmingham is clearly not restricted to Birmingham, as you so eloquently pointed out. What do you think can be done to change, to use your and the moral fiber of America? Myself, Jimmy Baldwin, and I think I'm speaking for a great many other Negroes too. I was 17. You've done everything that you could do to me. The problem now is, how are you going to save yourselves? The problem now is, how are you going to save yourselves?
Join me now in a time of centering. Breathe deeply and feel the power of quiet, where you are, aware of the life around you. Birds, friends, traffic sounds, sounds of life while you breathe. In and out, together with us all. In our lives together, may we offer one another comfort and support. We open our hearts to all who are troubled by things happening in our homes, our communities, our wider world. We join with our nation in mourning all the tragedies which have been with us for more than 2 years. The million COVID deaths, the killing of Black lives, the threats to full participation in our democracy. We pray for peace in the world, in Ukraine, and other countries and communities wherever there is suffering. May fighting cease. May love prevail. Amen. When we gather in community together, we remind ourselves what matters most to each of us. As we mourn our sorrows and celebrate our joys, we are encouraged by sharing with one another all that is in our hearts. We are part of an interdependent web. We are a community that cares for one another, and part of how we embody this care is by making time to share what is in our hearts, the experiences which bring us joy and sorrow. This community offers its love and support to what is closest to our hearts. Another way we show our care for one another is in sharing our financial gifts with our community and our congregation. May we please show the slide for giving? Each week, we invite everyone to the spiritual practice of generosity by giving to the ministry of our congregation. Through your pledges and with the weekly Sunday morning offering together, we build the future of our congregation and our larger community. This is our shared ministry. From you we receive, and to you we give. During the music which follows, you may choose to make your Sunday morning offering by using the text address or giving to our website. Here in the sanctuary, you may bring cash or checks forward. During this musical prayer of thanksgiving, you are invited to share not only financial gifts, but also you are invited to share the joys and sorrows in your hearts. Those on Zoom may put them in the chat box, and those of you at Rugby Road may come forward to place a stone in the water. The stone symbolizes what is in your heart, and the water represents the soothing embrace our caring community offers for your joys and sorrows. You may also leave us a note on the joy and sorrow paper provided here. I light a candle now for all the joys and sorrows in our hearts this morning. Let us hold one another in a compassionate embrace. Let us dedicate all the many gifts we share with one another by saying, we accept, we accept your gifts with gratitude. May we use them wisely for the highest good. You may come forward now with your gifts and your prayers. Thank you.
So, this sermon is inspired by a talk that I gave in New York in May called Jazz and Violence. It was an uncomfortable talk. It was dealing with the proximity of music I loved and valued and relating it to the long and painful history of violent racial injustice in America. Now, that's not the talk that I plan to give here. This is more of a Sunday morning talk than a Thursday evening talk. After that talk, though, I received a question which pointed me in a different direction. It said, what did jazz musicians do in response, or what do they do now in response to racial violence? And that's what prompts today's homily, which I was going to say tentatively, but here I am doing it, so I guess it's really the title, Jazz in Action. And for most of last week, I was essentially planning to kind of give a historical framework that would finally culminate in some interesting videos or demonstrations of what musicians do now. And after a while, I just began to realize, let's do that first. Let's get that stuff out front, because the answer for today is yes, jazz musicians do care about racial injustice. And the pandemic aside, which obviously affected jazz musicians more than most because they're really playing together and had difficulty doing so over the last 2 years, they use their music to address political issues whenever and wherever they can. So that reading that I gave to you, it may have been hard to hear what was going on, but it was an excerpt. It's one kind of piece that people present. It was called Baldwin, and it was an evocative setting of an interview with James Baldwin from a number of years ago, obviously, underscored with William Parker's bass and percussion, the trumpet playing of Jalalu Calvert-Nelson, and the electronic wizardry of Ellen Christie. It was serious, provocative, disturbing. That's one kind of approach that you can take. But political involvement can also be joyous, lighthearted, and physical, embodied. One of my heroes is John Batiste, who's probably best known today as the leader of the band Stay Human and is seen weekly on the Stephen Colbert Show on the NBC network. He's a brilliant piano player, an optimistic soul, committed to social change, and I'm proud to say shares my birthday. Makes me feel better. So I want to play for you here a video made by one of his alto players, Grace Kelly, during an outdoor march in 2020. If we could show that, please, Sean. Obviously, they've got a march to do, so they had to move on to that. So there are a few moments throughout jazz history that I would like to lift up and celebrate, even as they may touch on things that are painful to our hearts. For example, Billie Holiday. I don't think anyone ever took a braver step against the hideous crime of lynching as that particular singer, who began singing the famous song Strange Fruit in 1939. If you want, you can read more about it in the book by the same name, Strange Fruit, by David Margolick. Strange Fruit became part of her routine at Cafe Society, the liberal nightclub in New York where she performed regularly. When she did this song, all service would stop. Waiters, cashiers, busboys were all immobilized. The room went completely dark, save for a pin spot on Holiday's face. When she was finished and the lights went out, she was to walk off stage, and no matter how thunderous the ovation, she never returned for a bow. According to Barney Josephson, who ran the show at Cafe Society, my instructions were to walk off, period. People had to remember Strange Fruit, get their insides burned with it. Or to take another one that I love to use because it's one of the ways of connecting jazz to the civil rights movement, Charles Mingus's Fables of Phoebus, which requires us to review some basic information about an important episode in the civil rights movement, the integration of Central High School in Little Rock, Arkansas in 1957. You could show the first slide, Sean. Little Rock had spent its school funds building a magnificent high school for its white students, Central High. You can see the kind of effort that went into it. The black community had to raise its own money to build a sort of a pale shadow of this particular school for the black students. And of course, after the 1954 decision, Brown versus the Board of Education, they decided to integrate this high school. They chose a group of black students. Show the picture of the Little Rock Nine. These were specially chosen to be the kind of people who could stand up to the turmoil of integrating the chief high school in Little Rock. So they arrived on September 4th, 1957. If you could show the next slide. This is Governor Orville Phoebus, who essentially, there was a mob of screaming white people. If you could show the next slide. Sorry, I got those kind of reversed. Yes, they're a mob of white students there preventing the students from getting in. And it was Governor Orville Phoebus who called up the Arkansas National Guard, allegedly to protect the black students. But he did so by preventing them from entering the school. There's a famous picture of one student, Elizabeth Eckford, who, for whatever reason, I mean, this is in the day before cell phones, so she showed up at the gas station nearby. Everyone else was somewhere else, and she was by herself, and she found herself having to move through this crowd in order to try to, you know, at this point, she didn't know what to do. And this famous picture shows that woman behind screaming at her. I mean, this is a famous picture because, among other things, these two women actually met later in life and sort of reconciled after this whole thing was over. But this whole situation in Little Rock lasted for 19 days as the Arkansas National Guard continued to prevent the black students from entering, and Orville Phoebus ended up achieving a kind of notoriety in the South for standing up to the federal government, until finally Eisenhower nationalized the National Guard, requiring them to admit the students. But it was at this time that Charles Mingus wrote his piece, Fables of Phoebus. The original recording was an instrumental for Columbia, which was Mingus's main label at the time. And it's interesting to listen to because the only clue we have is the title, Fables of Phoebus, which of course people at that time would have known, you know, who Phoebus was and what he stood for. And listening to that music, which has a bitter, sarcastic edge, replete with moans, staccato phrasing, unexpected shifts in dynamics and tempo. If you could play the opening of that, please. That was it? Is that all you have, really?
There we go.
So it reminds me of Ellington's quote. He said, you can say anything you want with the trombone, but you got to be careful with words. But this isn't the extent of Mingus's protest. In a later recording, we find out that the piece did have words. Columbia refused to record the piece as a vocal version. It took him working with a very small Candid label to finally come up with a version that he called Original Phoebus Fables. Phoebus Fables, I think. I mean, the words are all mixed up, but okay. And the recording is peculiar because he decided to pretend that he was in a nightclub. So actually he starts with kind of instructions to people as to how to behave. It's kind of like what Billie Holiday's management was telling the audience at Cafe Society. If you could play it for me.
Thank you, ladies and gentlemen. Remember, no applause and keep it down. Your drinks, no rather your ice in your glasses, and don't ring the cash register. You got it covered? All right. I'd like to continue this set with a composition dedicated to the first or second or third All-American heel, Phoebus, and it's titled Fables of Phoebus. Oh, Lord, don't let them shoot us. Oh, Lord, don't let them stab us. Oh, Lord. Don't let them feather us, oh Lord, no more responsibility.
For us today, this feels heroic because it was just so standing up in the face of inaction on the part of the federal government. At the same time, I play that example because there's almost no other examples like that. There are very few people standing up in the way that Mingus stood up. And I think the basic reason is one factor, fear. There was actually one major figure who did stand up to the establishment in this period, if you can show the next slide, Paul Robeson, an amazing man for combining so many talents. He was valedictorian at his college. He was also an All-American athlete. He became a lawyer. He became a film star. He became a Shakespearean actor. He was a polylinguist, and I'm kind of saving the best for last. He was one of the great bass singers of our time. He was absolutely fearless as a global activist. In fact, to the point where he allied himself with the Soviet Union during the 1940s and 1950s. It actually wasn't that hard to align oneself with the Soviet Union during the World War, of course, because we were allied with them. But obviously, by the time you got into the 1940s, things suddenly became more difficult. And we'll get a chance to hear a bit of what Paul Robeson sounded like when he gave testimony before the House Un-American Activities Committee. So play some of that tape for me, please.
Tell this committee, please, while under oath, Mr. Robeson, the communists who participated in the preparation of that statement.
Oh, please. The reason I'm here today, from the mouth of the State Department itself, is I shall not be allowed to travel because I have struggled for the independence of the colonial peoples of Africa. The other reason I'm here today, again, from the State Department and from the record of the Court of Appeals, is that when I am abroad, I speak out against injustices against the Negro people in this land. That is why I'm here. I'm not being tried for whether I'm a communist. I'm being tried for fighting for the rights of my people, who are still second-class citizens in this country, in this United States of America. My mother was born in your state. My mother was a Quaker. My ancestors, in the time of Washington, baked bread for George Washington's troops when they crossed the Delaware. My father was a slave. I stand here struggling for the rights of my people to be full citizens in this country. And we are not. We are not in Mississippi. We are not in Montgomery, Alabama. We are not in Washington. We are nowhere. And that is why I'm here today. You want to shut up every Negro who has the courage to stand up and fight for the rights of his people, for the rights of workers. And I have been on many a picket line for the steel workers too. And that is why I'm here today.
Would you tell, while you were in Moscow, Mr. Robeson, did you make a speech lauding Stalin?
I can't remember.
Have you recently changed
what
your mind about Stalin?
What Stalin, gentlemen, is a question for the Soviet Union, and I won't argue with a representative of the people who, in building America, wasted the lives of my people. You are responsible, you and your forebears, for 60 to 100 million black people dying in the slave ships and on the plantations. Don't you ask me about anybody.
I'm sure you wouldn't want to discuss with us the slave labor camps in the Soviet Union.
Nothing can be built more on slavery than this society, I assure you.
I would invite your attention to the Daily Worker of June 29, 1949, with reference to a get-together with you and Ben Davis, formerly Communist Councilman in New York. Do you know Ben
Davis?
One
of my dearest friends. He is as patriotic an American as can be. And you, gentlemen, are the non-patriot.
Just a minute.
You are the un-American.
The hearing is now adjourned.
I think it should be.
I've been doing all of this that I can.
Can I read my statement?
No! The meeting is adjourned.
It should be.
Yeah. We applaud now, but obviously that was an extremely dangerous stance to take. And the State Department did take away his passport for 8 years. This is during a time when he was a global activist. He had two concerts he gave right on the Canadian border so that he could at least sing for some people, somewhere else. This, of course, is before Zoom or anything like that. So all of this, I mean, and eventually they broke Robeson. His health failed. He gave his last tour in 1960, and he spent the last 15 years of his life after a stroke, kind of a broken man. And there are plenty of jazz musicians who are seeing what happened to Robeson, and they didn't want any part of that. Fear was a big part of what was happening. Let me turn to Sonny Rollins, if you could put up the next slide. In 1958, he released an album called The Freedom Suite. And you can see this cover. He's there without a shirt, with those bars on the left that look a bit like jail bars. The title for The Freedom Suite is a 20-minute instrumental piece for tenor, sax, bass, and drums, just a trio. It's hardly a political piece. I could play it for you, but you'd hear this 8-bar section that kind of turns into a short cycle, and you'd be kind of wondering exactly what the point was. But on the back, Sonny Rollins added a brief statement that clearly he spent some time composing. He said it was his attempt, later said it was his attempt to bring black experience to jazz listeners. He said, "America is deeply rooted in Negro culture. its colloquialisms, its humor, its music. How ironic that the Negro, who more than any other people can claim America's culture as his own, is being persecuted and repressed, that the Negro, who has exemplified the humanities in his very existence, is being rewarded with inhumanity. And that's the extent of it. And there were liner notes around it. He got a tremendous amount of feedback, not positive feedback, from this. In fact, the record label ended up retitling this album Shadow Waltz after another tune because they were embarrassed or whatever by the fact that this title does have this. Just the title was enough to freak people out. And those two sentences that Sonny Rollins wrote. Well, Sonny Rollins is not really a very verbal person anyway. And actually, we'll get a chance to hear him being involved with a very different kind of American tragedy. In 2001, he was in his apartment in Lower Manhattan when his life was interrupted by the sound of one and then two airplanes crashing into the World Trade Center. He was just six blocks away. All the residents in that area were immediately evacuated. And TV reporters noted that there was an elderly gentleman among them carefully cradling a tenor saxophone. Of course, it was Rollins explaining he had a gig in a few days and he thought he needed to carry this out to make sure that he could get to it. That gig was in Boston a few days later. It was released eventually as the 9/11 concert. Yeah, you've got that up there. And you can hear on the recording during his introductions, and of course, Rollins is by this point 70 years old, him trying to explain what he was doing. If you could play that tape, please.
Yes, ladies and gentlemen, we're here tonight, and we must remember that music is one of the beautiful things of life, so we have to try to keep the music alive some kind of way. And maybe music can help. I don't know, but we have to try something these days, right?
Maybe music can help. In some ways, I think the most heroic thing Sonny Rollins could do was to pick up that saxophone and play. Why? Why does that help? After all the things that we've talked about that were attempts to directly insert themselves into the political discourse, why does music by itself work? Here's my theory, and I derive it mostly from the work of Christopher Small, who's the author of several books, including Music of the Common Tongue. And central to Small's arguments is that we misunderstand the word music. Music is not a noun. It's not a thing. We might assume that it is from classical music, where music is something that is created in advance of the performance. I mean, like a Beethoven symphony is a thing. It's written out, it's published, it's in the music library. This is how classical music works. And Small says, no, music is not a noun, it's a verb, like dance. It's an activity, it's something we do. We don't normally say that we music, so he actually coined a word which served as the title of another of his books, musicking, with a K. And he said, musicking is something that we all do. Everyone involved in a music event is musicking. It's not just composition and performance, but it's listening, hearing, grooving, vibing, dancing, however we relate to it. We all music. We all can music, even though we're told by a lot of the music establishment that some people are musical and the rest of you are not. That's not true. We all music just as we all communicate. Okay, sorry, I was wondering where that came from. And here's the next phase in the argument. Communication is not just about passing on information. When we converse, there's a deeper level. Conversation, according to Small, is primarily about establishing identity. It's about making clear who you and I are, as individuals, perhaps, but at the same time, and perhaps more important, as members of a community. When we converse with one another, we take part in the central goal of human life, which is the quest for establishing who we truly are. So how does musicking fit in? How does Sonny Rollins' performance help us to get this? We can think of music as a meta form of conversation. It's an artistic idealization, not just the interaction of sounds, but the interaction of musicians as people, having a conversation through music. A meaningful musical performance is a miracle. It represents for us an ideal society. When we feel our lives shattered by events, when acts of violence disrupt our world and damage our faith that we can work together, a musical performance is not only a reminder that a beautiful world exists, it actually incarnates that beauty for us to share, for us to music in. As Small writes, we find music moving, quote, because musicking creates the image of our most inwardly desired relationships. It does not just show them to us as they might be, but it actually brings them into existence for the duration of the performance. Now, everybody has their own idea about what an ideal society is, so there are many, many types of music that can do it. I've been presenting you jazz because that's my particular passion, and jazz at least is an improvised conversation. It's perhaps more openly conversational than most, but it's just one way out of many out of bringing all this into being for all of us. May we all use music to find the best way to negotiate this world. Thank you. Hello, yes, okay, well, we do have a hymn to do, and I've got to make sure that I've got, well, actually, I could just, can you get the text of the hymn up here? This is probably one that you're not likely to know, but it's a beautiful, beautiful hymn, and it's just one that I love to sing. It's called When in Our Music. Can you play through it once, just so we can hear it? 2, 3, 4. God is glorified, and adoration leaves no room for pride. It is as though the whole creation cried, Alleluia. How often making music we have found a new dimension in the world of sound. As worship moved us to a more profound Alleluia, so has the church in liturgy and song, in faith and love through centuries of wrong, born witness to the truth in every tongue, Alleluia. Let every instrument be tuned for praise. Let all rejoice who have a voice to raise. And may God give us faith to sing always. Alleluia.
Thank you, Scott, John, our guest musicians, and our choir for that inspiring musical service. May we all use the gift of music or the other gifts at our service to create the ideal society. As the postlude now plays, consider how you can bring into existence your most inwardly desired relationships. Enjoy the rest of your day.